Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our service today, Sunday. Just over 2 weeks into lockdown, so things we're doing things a little bit differently. This is the third part of a series on love. So let me just begin with a word of prayer. Lord, be present with us today, wherever we are and whatever we're doing. I pray that you will give us patience at this time of lockdown. Help us to use our time wisely and to draw closer to you. Keep us aware of the needs of those around us, and may we continually demonstrate your love to those near to us. Speak to us through this message today. May we all hear from you. Amen. So the passage we've been working through, and Christine did a great job last Sunday. I hope I can, what I do will be up to her standard. And anyway, the passage we're looking at is from 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 4 to 7. Love is patient and kind. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. It does not demand its own way. It is not irritable and keeps no record of being wrong. It does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Love never gives up, never loses faith, is always hopeful, and endures through every circumstance. So what we are looking at today is love is always hopeful. Could put it that love is, that hopeful is being confident, expectant, faithfully anticipating. And this is the nature of the love God has for you and me. William Barclay's put it like this: love is the light which turns hope into certainty. So I suppose the question for me is what is God really like? Can we trust him? The one who has called us out of darkness into his glorious light, the one who made the universe, can he be trusted? Can we put our hope in him and what he says? Somebody said, God promises a safe landing, not a calm passage. And this reminds me of a time many years ago, when I was in a plane taking off from Manila. We were on the runway, we were taking off, and this guy sitting next to me, who had already told me he'd traveled extensively, said, we're taking a long time to lift off the runway. And I remember thinking, thanks for that. I did not want to hear that, as I hadn't flown much at that stage. That wasn't very reassuring. In fact, made me quite scared. And I suppose it's an example of where does our hope lie. My hope should have been in the pilot. He knew what he was doing, but instead I was staring out the window listening to the passenger sitting next to me, speculating about whether we were going to make it or not. Instead, I should have been relying on what I, not relying on what I could see or hear to guide me, because I was getting an incorrect message, but I should have been putting my trust in those who really knew what they were doing, the pilots. And thankfully, we took off fine. I need not have been worried or concerned. Our hope lies in the next life, of which we know little about. That's where faith comes into it. Our hope is rooted in our understanding of who God is. It's based upon the trustworthiness of our God. It is centered on history. God has proven himself utterly reliable through the decades, through the years. And so our hope is grounded on fact, not fantasy. Our hope is certain because we can trust God to keep his promises. Hebrews 10 says, "Let us hold tightly without wavering to the hope we affirm." Why? Because God can be trusted. He can be trusted to keep his promise. Looking at my life, I can see the hand of God at work, looking back. Although I have to admit, things don't always turn out the way I expected. And I've had crises of faith. I've had a health crisis or several. And so I had to learn. When I first committed my life to Jesus, I had a cautious optimism that I was doing the right thing. But it took time. It took time for me to gain more confidence that God was who he said he was. And there were many times I had to learn that God could be trusted. I remember I was a single student when I was a single student at university. I hadn't long been a committed Christian. I had this hope that one day I'd get married. Of course, I had to tell all my mates that I was a confirmed bachelor for life. But my hope really was that God was in control of my life and he would sort things out for the best. He would be able to find for me a good wife. And he did eventually. But it wasn't the way I expected, and it wasn't according to my timeline. But I learned, or began to learn, that God is reliable. He's truthful. He does keep his promises. God is with us, ahead of us, opening a way in which we can responsibly follow. And so the next thing I had to learn was that despite changing situations and circumstances, the love God has for me and the hope that he has given all his faithful followers doesn't change. A few years ago, I still do, listen to Rich Mullins' music, and he has a song he's titled "Ready for the Storm," and it goes, the lyrics go like this: "Oh, I'm ready for the storm, yes, sir, I'm ready, I'm ready for the storm, yes, sir, ready." And when I first heard it, I kept thinking, "No, I'm not ready for the storm." Well, I didn't think I was. No, Lord, keep life easy. Without any big difficulties or major crises, my prayer was, "No storms, please, God." And then the savage storm came. It was really tough. But Rich Mullins in his song puts it quite well. "And when you take me by the hand and you love me, Lord, you love me, and I should have realized I had no reason to be frightened." Love never gives up, never loses hope, never loses faith, is always hopeful and endures through every circumstance. That is the love God has for us. Biblical hope is not a kind of everything will be all right wishful thinking. Nor is it considering something to be so because, well, you know, we desire it to be so. Could call that positivism. I remember going, as we prepared to go to India, well, we didn't know we were going to India at that point. We asked God to confirm our decision. And Gillian, my wife, she had much more faith than me in some ways. And she said, God, I want, in the next couple of days, I want four signs that we're to go to India. And we got those signs, quite obvious signs. And so we thought it must be God leading us. It's the right place to go. So we packed our bags and headed off to India, hopeful of great things. And then we arrived in Varanasi and we were sick for 2 weeks, every one of us. And so you start going, what's going on here, God? Are we really in your will? Everything is going wrong, right? So maybe we got it wrong. Maybe, yeah. We had to learn the God who was with his people in the past will be with them always. God is with us in trouble and in triumph. In the difficulties, we had to learn, or I had to learn, that God guides us. Sometimes it's going to be difficult, sometimes it'll be easy. Christian hope is deep. The New Testament talks about the patience of hope. Hope, as somebody's John Macquarie said, hope is humble, trustful, and vulnerable. Optimism is arrogant, brash, and complacent. So be strong and courageous, all of you who put your hope in the Lord. That's what we needed when we arrived in India. Courage. The courage to believe that, yes, we were doing what God wanted us to do. I pray that the God, the source of hope, will fill you completely with joy and peace because you trust in Him. Then you will overflow with confident hope through the power of the Holy Spirit. And so, Lord, where do I put my hope? My hope is in you alone. Really, the Bible's answer for any person or a church is biblical hope deals with imagining possibilities than having the faith to work hard to see those possibilities realized. So my question for you today is, what promise has God given that you know you are to hold on to? What do you promise do you need to hold on today that God has given you? Just want to pause while you think about that. Today is Resurrection Sunday. Few days ago, Jesus was dead. Savior of the world was now buried in a tomb. I wonder what was going through the mind of the disciples at this time. If you had been there on Good Friday, would you have? What would have your thoughts been? Would you have been hopeful? Or would you have by this time lost all hope? On Friday, we built a cross and decorated it with flowers and butterflies because we knew it was Good Friday. We knew what was going to happen 3 days later. Like the crocus flower that bloomed this weekend, a beautiful flower that came out of the dirt. So Jesus was not finished. Death was not the end. G.K. Chesterton puts it this way: on the third day, The friends of Christ coming at daybreak to the place found the grave empty and the stone rolled away. In varying ways, they realized the new wonder, but even they hardly realized that the world had died in the night. What they were looking for was the first day of a new creation with a new heaven and a new earth. And in a semblance of the garden, God walked again in the garden in the cool, not of the evening, but of the dawn. Love hopes. This is Resurrection Sunday. He isn't here. He is no longer in the tomb. He is risen from the dead. We live and die. Christ died and lived. It's a wonderful, I really like it, beautiful piece of music. Try and play it for you now. I know that my Redeemer. tomb is empty. My Redeemer lives. I don't know. We were lucky before the lockdown. Gillian managed to get some Easter eggs. These were actually for icons, but I don't know if you've opened your Easter eggs yet. Oh, it's empty. There's nothing in there. Yeah, the tomb is empty. My Redeemer lives. Death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where is your victory? Where is your sting? For sin is the sting that results in death, and the law gives sin its power. But thank God, He gives us victory over sin and death through our Lord Jesus Christ. A sure hope. It's a sure hope we have that on the last days we shall rise with him. I heard a loud shout from the throne saying, "Look, God's home is now among his people. He will live with them, and they will be his people. God himself will be with them. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death or sorrow or crying or pain. All these things are gone forever." And the one sitting on the throne said, "Look, I am making everything new." I really like a series of songs. They're up on YouTube from St. Paul's, Auckland. And one of them, this is the lyrics from it, "You are alive, I cannot stay silent." So let's see if I can play some of that for you. Alive, I cannot stay silent. With heaven we cry, Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Happy Easter. Let me just finish with a prayer. God, give me gifts of patience and hope. Make us more constant in our love for you and our trust in you. In loving you, let us believe, and in believing, let us love. And in loving and in believing, let us hope for a more perfect love and a more unwavering faith through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Be our comforter and ever-present help in this time of the pandemic. And be with those who are ministering and living in very difficult situations. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whose loving kindness we have been born anew, born to a living hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, born to an inheritance which will never perish or fade away, kept for us in heaven. Amen.